Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to the program today. My name is Bill Young, and you are watching Faith is a Lifestyle. This morning on the program, we're going to continue our series that I started, oh boy, I guess a month ago, called The Many Levels of Grace. This is segment four, or part four, and I think you'll learn some valuable things this morning that'll help you, that will strengthen your walk with Christ and make you more effective in your life as a believer. And so get your Bibles, and we'll get into the Word here momentarily. And as we have been doing for some time, we're doing a dual mode broadcast this morning. We are live streaming on Facebook, so hello to all the Facebook people, and also recording for our YouTube page and our website. And our website is a valuable resource that you can take advantage of 24/7, 365. If you visit us online at mgcconline.org, there you'll find a resource in our messages section of over 450, 60 video messages, audio messages, articles, a lot of information that you can take advantage of. So if you want to study up on a certain subject, or if you're having difficulty in a particular area, or if you want to help somebody, send them to our website. There you'll find all the information if you just go to the resources tab and hit messages. I want to take care of a little housekeeping stuff, a little inside stuff for all of our MGCC people. It is obviously the beginning of a new year, and so I want to let everybody know that all of our giving statements are in the mail. So, all right, let's get into our lesson today. We began this study a month ago in 1 Peter chapter 4. And Paul, Peter, James, all of these writers encouraged the church, which is not a building, by the way, but the church is the ecclesia, the called out ones. They all encouraged believers to find their place, if you will, in the body of Christ, and to become effective in serving. And so Peter wrote some things that really give us a lot of insight, and I think Paul had a little more insight than perhaps some of the others, and really laid out some wonderful things. But we want to look at what Peter said, 1 Peter 4:10, he talked about being good stewards of the manifold grace of God. So grace has many facets, or many colors, or many attributes. In the Old Testament, when you find the word grace, it basically refers to God's favor. But in the New Testament, grace takes on a different dimension. And so the Bible talks about saving grace. We know that we're saved by grace through faith. There's an important point we need to understand, that salvation is available to everybody through grace, but you have to walk through the door of faith to receive it. Just because it's available doesn't mean you're going to walk in it. And so there is saving grace. There's also standing grace. God will give you the ability to stand in difficult situations, in times of trouble, in tribulation. You know, it reminds me of the account in Mark chapter 4 when Jesus told the disciples, you know, let's go to the other side of the lake. They were headed to the land of the Gadarenes, and a storm came up. And Jesus is in the boat sleeping on a pillow. The disciples, who happened to be, many of them now, professional fishermen, are bailing water left and right, full of fear. And finally, they wake Jesus up and say, Master, don't you, our live stream just disappeared. Let's see, I think we got it back. Okay, I don't know what happened there, but the live stream video cut off. But anyway, they wake Jesus up and say, Master, don't you care, we're all gonna die. And he's asleep on a pillow, and or in the back of the boat. And so he wakes up and says, you know, why are you afraid, and where's your faith? In the midst of a storm, in the midst of a very, very deadly situation, Jesus wasn't upset. He wasn't fretting. He was sleeping. And so that may be an extreme version of it, but God will give you standing grace in the midst of difficult situations. I just want to take a moment. I don't know what happened with our Facebook crew. The signal just went, so we did reconnect. Anyway, there's serving grace as well as standing grace and saving grace. We want to focus on serving grace. That's what we've been talking about for the last couple weeks. Now, we want to talk about the ability that God gives. This is where we left off last week. If any man speak, this is from Romans chapter 12, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God gives, that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. So this word ability is the Greek word iskous, which literally means force, strength, or might. And many times this is where we can fumble the ball or drop the ball, so to speak, because we think that anything we do for God has to be done in our own strength or has to be done out of our own resources. Now, there is a correlation there. God will use what you have to accomplish His purpose and plan, but don't stop there. There's so much more that you can take advantage of. God's ability, His force, His strength, His might far exceeds what you can ever accomplish in your own strength. I like what I heard somebody say many, many years ago. The Holy Spirit can do more in a moment than we can accomplish in a lifetime of human effort. But if we stick and lock ourselves into human effort, we're going to miss it. We will never become what God wants us to be. We will never accomplish what God wants us to do because we limit ourselves to our own ability and our own strength. And so that's what we want to talk about a little bit today. Now, last week and the week before, I mentioned some people, ordinary people who I've encountered and known through the years, who tapped into something that was beyond their own resource or their own ability. I talked about a man that I met, Vern Norton. The guy is gifted. God has equipped this man to evangelize, if you will, to win souls. And a friend of mine told me that this man personally, by himself, one-on-one and in small groups, had won over 60,000 people to a relationship with Jesus Christ. 60,000 by himself. I talked about a worship leader that I knew, Doyle Tucker. I've never seen anybody in my life as anointed in music as Doyle Tucker. I mean, literally, just blew me away. There were great men of God that would come and preach at our church, blew them away. They were just stunned, but he had a gift that came from heaven that went beyond his own ability. Now, let me say something just for a moment. Many times, and this is particularly true, and I'm gonna speak in the two person because Minister Heidelberg is here with me. And I'm going to ask you a question, Minister Heidelberg. We haven't talked about this, all right? But most of our generation, all right, R&B singers, gospel singers, soul singers, all that entertainment, where did it come from? Where did it start?
From God.
From God. But where did these people get their start?
Church.
In church. That's right. Almost every one of them got their start in church, singing in a choir or singing in churches, and then turned and went to the secular route because they figured that's what they had to do to succeed and to earn a living and to make money. And I dare say, you know, and we appreciate them all. I'm not criticizing anybody. Now, understand, I'm not one of these ultra holiness people that believes it's a sin to listen to secular music. I listen to secular music. Listen, secular music in and of itself is not wrong. It's the message you have to watch out for. And so I don't care who the artist is, if the message violates godly principles, then you need not listen to it. But just because it's quote unquote secular doesn't mean it's bad. And, you know, back in the day, I was right there, I'm telling you. And I often tell the story, you MGCC people have heard it before, but I remember when I was seeking after the things of God, and as a young guy, I was in my probably 19, 20, I found myself at a Commodores concert in Pittsburgh, and never will forget it. They were jamming, singing Brick House, and I'm standing there observing this scene. The noise is deafening, and I like the Commodores. You know, it's a good group. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me right in the midst of that noise and confusion and asked me a question. What are you doing here? And it was an eye-opener for me. It reminds me of what the Lord did when Elijah ran from Jezebel. Remember that? Finds himself in a tree. Here comes the Lord. And what's he asking? What are you doing here? You know? And when he asked me that, what are you doing here? I'm like, Lord, I don't know. I don't know. But I realized I was on the wrong path. I was headed in the wrong direction. For God to accomplish his purpose and plan in my life, it wasn't going to get done that way. So I had to make a change, and I did. And but anyway, you know, we have to understand that God many times will grace people with gifts, but you need to use those gifts for the right reason. Now, many times the reason people go a secular route or a route other than what God intended is simply a lack of faith. They don't understand what he can do. They don't understand what's available to them. And so they limit themselves to their own resources, their own gifts, talents, and abilities when there's something far better waiting for you. Just amazing. Anyway, my friend Doyle Tucker was such not only an inspiration, but such a blessing to so many people. And he ministered to people through music by the Spirit of God. And it wasn't goofy stuff, but it was right on point. And it's something I've never seen before. I had never seen before and have rarely seen since. But that man was anointed to minister to people through music. And then he went out into ministry and did some preaching and teaching and things like that. But put that man on a keyboard, oh, Lord, you know, I've never seen anything like it. And just amazing. So we talked about some people who were graced and gifted in different areas. And here's the thing I want you to see. These graces and these gifts go beyond the four walls of the church. It's not just so you can have a great church service. And you're going to see that as we get into this next portion of Scripture. If you would, turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. We talked about the ability which God gives. And I'm going to show you, if we have time, how the ability that God gives can shake a region. Not just a city, but a region. If you follow after the Holy Spirit. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1 says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. Now, notice that word called, I think it's a word, kaleo, it means to call out loud, you know, like somebody calling your name. Now, Ephesians chapter 4, 1, walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. This is a letter to the church and the saints in Ephesus. This is not a memo to the ministerial association. This is not a letter to the pastor's group. This was a letter to the church. And so he's letting us know that there is a calling that's available, and it's not just for what we consider to be ministers. Notice verse 7, Ephesians 4. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. So every one of us is given grace. And we need to understand that with grace comes gifts. And so grace is not just given to ministers, or what we refer to as fivefold ministers. Grace is given to everybody in the body of Christ. To every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Now, there's a little insight there. According to the measure or metron of the gift of Christ, I truly believe that all of us corporately as the body of Christ have the same gifting as Jesus did in his earthly ministry. And the Bible says that God gave him the Spirit without measure, which implies that we have the Spirit by measure. And here you can plainly see it according to the measure of the gift of Christ. We have a measure. We're not unlimited, but we're limited. But listen, when we put all of our limits together, I truly believe it reflects the character and the power that Jesus had in his earthly ministry. But we are limited. We just have a measure of that gift or that grace. Now, notice verse 11. And he gave some. You need to underline that word some. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Now, here's something you have to understand. When you sense that calling, and you know the word vocation here, walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you were called. The word vocation, klesis, simply means an invitation to serve. So all of us have been given an invitation to serve in some capacity. Now some serve as apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers, and there's a reason why. Some are called to do what we call or refer to as fivefold ministry. That's where the term comes from, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. That is what we refer to as fivefold ministry, but some are called to fivefold ministry. Most are not. Some are called. Now, here's where we make a mistake. Many times people sense in their heart that invitation to serve, that tugging in their heart to get involved, and serve in the church. And so they assume that if they're called, they've got to be either a pastor or an evangelist. And that's a mistake. Because if God hasn't equipped you to be a pastor or an evangelist, you're either going to be mediocre or you're going to fail miserably. Because God never called you to do that. And so what you need to do is understand the breadth of the grace that God has made available to you. Maybe God called you to the ministry of helps. We looked at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning with verse 28, and God has set some of the church. You know, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers. After that, miracles, gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. Maybe God has called you to one of those things, but if you're not in an environment where they appreciate and teach you about those gifts, it's going to be very difficult for you to find the right place. And so everybody who is in ministry and perhaps doing the work of a pastor, it doesn't mean that's what you were called to do. Everybody who calls himself an evangelist or a prophet is not an evangelist or a prophet. And I'm not a critic. I'm not a judge. But I'm trying to show you that the grace of God has a broader depth than what we have perceived. And many of these grace gifts will impact the world outside the church, not just within the four walls of the church. Now, why did God give us fivefold ministry of these ministry gifts? Verse 11, and he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. Notice this, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. In other words, these fivefold ministry gifts have been designed to equip the saints so that they can do the work of the ministry. Now, how do you do the work of the ministry? With the ability that God gives. And here are some other translations of verse 11. The Amplified said, and he did this to fully equip and perfect the saints, God's people, for works of service to build up the body of Christ, the church. The Contemporary English Bible says his purpose was to equip God's people for the work of serving and building up the body of Christ. The New Living Translation says their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ. Another translation says their job is to give God's people the equipment that they need for their work of service, so to build up the King's body. And so here we can see that we all have a part to play. We're all involved in this together. And part of our job, my job, as a pastor, is to equip you so that you can tap into the grace that God has placed on your life and do it with the ability that God gives. And your part and my part and everybody else's part will strengthen and build up the body of Christ so that we can fulfill his purpose and plan. And so it all works together, just like a human body. You know, everybody can't be a nose, everybody can't be an ear, everybody can't be a foot, but we all have a very important part to play. You can be the strongest man in the world, but if your feet don't work, you got a problem, you know? And so we have to understand how it all works together. And it really, really gets to be exciting when it all works together. And many times it's going to work together outside the walls of the church. Now, how does this depart from traditional Christianity? And many times it's a cultural thing, but there are so many people who, you know, get up on Sunday morning and you know, go to church out of duty, if you will, and they basically go to be entertained. Hopefully the pastor's going to get wound up this morning and he's going to, you know, hoop a little bit and do all of that stuff. And, you know, I always found that was a little disappointing, you know. All right, preacher hoops a little bit and folk get happy and then 2 hours later, nothing has changed. I really believe that ministry is designed to equip us, to teach us, to train us, to prepare us so that we can do what we're supposed to do in the kingdom of God. And, as I say many, many times, church is not a spectator sport. In fact, Paul said this in 1 Corinthians. He said, "How is it, brethren, when you come together, every one of you has a psalm, has a revelation, has a tongue?" You know, and he said, "Let all these things be done decently in order." Now, he's writing to the church at Corinth, and he said about this church, when it comes to gifts or manifestations of the Holy Spirit, you are second to none. I mean, nobody has more manifestations of the Holy Spirit than you do. And he talked about particularly revelation gifts and vocal gifts, prophecy, revelation. He said, "How is it when you come together, every one of you has a tongue, has a revelation?" In other words, these people came, and when they gathered together, these people came to bring something. They weren't coming to take something away. They had a word from God. They had a revelation. They had a tongue with an interpretation. I like to say it like this. They came loaded for bear. I mean, these people were ready. And so you can see the contrast, if you will. Whereas many times people come to church to receive, and we should, but many times God will grace and gift you not just to get something, but to give something, to be a blessing to somebody, to encourage somebody. And you don't have to sound a bullhorn when you do it. Many times the Lord has impressed upon me to do things on behalf of other people, give people things. I didn't announce it. You know, I didn't tell everybody what I did. I didn't sound a bullhorn. In fact, I remember one time I was in the grocery store and I was in line and I was, you know, about to pay for my groceries. I happened to look behind me and there was an older woman and I could see her counting her money, trying to make sure she had enough to buy the stuff that she had. You know, no big deal. And while I'm standing there, the Holy Spirit whispered to me, buy her food. Okay, well, I know his voice. And so I looked back and, you know, made sure I gave the guy at the cash register more than enough money to pay for her groceries. And I counted it out. He didn't know who I was. He didn't know who she was. As far as he was concerned, she was my grandma. He didn't know. But she wasn't. I didn't know this woman. Never seen her before. Haven't seen her since. And I gave him the money. I said, this is to pay for her groceries and give her the change. And you know what I did next? I left the store. I didn't stand in the foyer with my chest stuck out. My name is Minister Young, and I just wanted you to know that God told me to give you. Nah, come on. That's pride. That's ignorance. Just obey the Lord and move on. And that's what I did. And I'm sure she was shocked and stunned, but hey, I did what the Lord told me to do. That's all I can do. And but don't do it, and my point is this, don't do it for a wrong motive. Don't do it to be seen. Don't do things and sound a trumpet before you. Jesus didn't do that. In fact, many times when he ministered to people, and that's where the ability that God gives kicks in, he was moved with compassion. He'd heal somebody, and then he'd pull them aside and say, don't tell anybody. Well, I didn't get to what I wanted to get to. I'll do that next week. I'm going to show you how the body of Christ working together and appreciating the grace that God has put on your life can change your region. Paul did some things that, as far as Scripture goes, nobody had ever done, but it shook up a region. Everybody in the region heard the gospel because of what God had done. Well, I hope you learned something this morning, and I apologize to our Facebook people. We had a little minor disruption, but I just want to tell you that we're here for you. You can always go to our website, mgcconline.org. And check out all of our resources. We've got a bunch of information there. For those of you who are faithful MGCC members and friends, thank you for your faithful giving. You guys have really made a difference, and we appreciate each and every one of you. And as I said at the beginning of the video, all of our giving statements are in the mail, so you should be receiving them shortly. All right? Hey, that's all the time we have for today. So until next week, keep putting your faith in God's Word.
Will you clap your hands right here? Come on.
With power.